Scale of justice will be broke before man. Now you shall have to explain your whole lifespan. What you did in the open and what you can't see.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبد الله ورسوله Brothers and sisters in Islam السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن صحيح الإمام مسلم Hadith Hudayfah ibn Asid al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu, he said, one day we were sitting with the companions and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam appeared by all the sudden and he asked us, what are you doing? What are you studying? The companions answered by saying, O Messenger of Allah, we are talking about the hour. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the day of judgment or the hour will not come until you see 10 signs, Ad-Dukhan, and he named Ad-Dukhan, the smoke, Ad-Dajjal, the Antichrist, Ad-Dabbah, the beast, Tulu' al-Shamsi min Maghribiha, the sun rising from the west, Nuzul Isa ibn Maryam, the descendants of Isa alayhi salam, the second coming of Prophet Isa alayhi salam, وخروج يأجوج ومأجوج, and يأجوج and مأجوج, and three landslides, one in the east, one in the west, and one of the Arabian Peninsula, and the last of the signs will be a fire that will erupt in Aden, in the middle of Aden, that will drive people to their reckoning. Brothers and sisters in Islam, today we want to talk about one of the missions of Prophet Isa alayhi salam. We talked about his second coming in the last episode, and today we want to talk about one of the things that he will handle is Ya'juj and Ma'juj. In hadith al-Nawas ibn Sam'an al-Kilabi radiyallahu anhu, and the hadith al-Imam Muslim, the hadith in Sahih al-Imam Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that after Prophet Isa alayhi salam kills the Antichrist, people will come to him. Muslims, followers of the proper creed, will come to Prophet Isa alayhi salam. He will wipe over their heads and he will remind them of their ranks, their status in Jannah. And at this time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reveal to Prophet Isa alayhi salam that I have allowed, I have decreed for slaves of mine to exit, to be released, and no one can stand in their face, no one can stand in their ways. So take my servants, take the Muslims, and seek refuge and protection in the mountain of At-Tur. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam is talking about the two tribes of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about those two tribes in the Quran in two surahs, Surah Al-Anbiya and Surah Al-Kahf. In Surah Al-Anbiya, حتى إذا فتحت يأجوج ومأجوج وهم من كل حدب ينسلون واقترب الوعد الحق فإذا هي شاخصة أبصار الذين كفروا يا ويلنا قد كنا في غفلة من هذا بل كنا ظالمين. Until the time will come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow يأجوج and مأجوج to be released, and they will come down from all high hills and high tops of the hills, and at this time that disbelievers will recognize that this is the true promise, that Ya'juj and Ma'juj are one of the major signs of the day of resurrection. Brothers and sisters in Islam, who are Ya'juj and Ma'juj? They are from the offspring of Adam alayhi salam. Yes, they are. Those two tribes are from the offspring of Adam alayhi salam. What is the evidence? Hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, and the hadith in Sahih al-Imam al-Bukhari wa Muslim. In the day of resurrection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call Abun Adam, Ya Adam, Allah, Adam عليه السلام, our father, will answer by saying, لبيك وسعديك والخير بين يديك, answering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in so sweet, in a sweet way, that I'm responding to you and all goodness comes from you, O Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command Adam عليه السلام, أخرج بعث النار, take out the dwellers of the hellfire from your offspring. Adam عليه السلام will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يا رب وما بعث النار, who are the dwellers of the fire from my offspring? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inform Adam alayhi salam, min kulli alfin. Listen to this carefully, because the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reacted in a scary way. And you should look at this. Out of each 1,000 of your offspring, 999 will go to the hellfire. That means what? Only one person will go to Jannah. Ya Allah. The companions looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they said, Ya Rasulullah, wa ayyuna dhaka al-wahid? Who's going to be this one? And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abshiru, glad tiding. From Ya'juj and Ma'juj, 999, and from you, one. That means that the majority of the people who will be the dwellers of the hellfire will be from those two tribes, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, because of the evil that they will cause in earth, right before when they were placed behind a wall, and even after they are released, and after they find a way out and they exit. And we will explain this inshallah in this episode and the episode to come bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued giving the glad tidings to the companions who were concerned about that rate or that ratio, and he said, wallahi, wallahi inni la arju an takunu rub'a ahli al-jannah. By Allah, I'm hoping that you're going to be quarter, one-fourth of the dwellers of Jannah. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahu Akbar. And then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wallahi inni la arju an takunu thuluth ahli al-jannah. By Allah, I making dua and I'm hoping that you will be third of the people of Jannah. And later on, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and I'm hoping that you will be half of the dwellers of Jannah. أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. الشاهد, or the important thing from this hadith, brothers and sisters in Islam, that Ya'juj and Ma'juj from the offspring of our father Adam عليه السلام. Because there is a fairy tale out there that they say that they are from another descendants. Listen, we all come from Adam عليه السلام. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة. O mankind, they are men, they are human beings. O mankind, have taqwa in your Lord who created you from one soul, and from that soul he created the mate or the wife, and from it came the rest of humanity. Brothers and sisters in Islam, what is the story of Ya'juj and Ma'juj? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that story in a surah that we are supposed to read at the time of this fitan, or by reading that surah, or by memorizing that surah, or by reciting the first 10 verses and the last 10 verses and some wording, or by reciting the whole surah, it will actually become a protection to us against the trials and tribulations that we are explaining, which Dajjal and the Antichrist and all of this. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us how did they exist and what their story and why they will be released at the end of time. The Quran and the Sunnah, they work together. But here is how the story started. Listen, and the one who compiled that story is Muhammad ibn Ishaq, one of the very famous predecessors who was good in compiling tafsir and the events, and especially the issues that have to deal with the debates that happened between the Muslims and the non-Muslims at the time, the disbelievers in Mecca. Here is what he said. The disbelievers in Mecca at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after they given up dealing with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by force, and they saw that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is impacting a lot of the people in Mecca, they decided to attack him through a different way. They said, let's discredit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in front of his followers, and by doing so they will find out that he is not receiving any revelation from divine. So they sent two of the disbelievers to Medina, to the Jews, the people of the book in Medina, Nadr ibn al-Harith, Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt, to basically tell them, listen, we have this man, here is they are referring to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who claims that he's a prophet and he receives the revelations from the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are people of the book, can you help us out? Can you give us some hints? How can we quiz him? How can we discredit him? So the Jews told those two disbelievers, go and ask him those three questions. Ask him about group of young men who disappeared. They had a very interesting story and they disappeared. The Jews here, or Bani Israel here, are talking about the youth, the companions of the cave. And ask him about a man who toured earth. And this is, by the way, Mawdu' al-Shahid. Somebody whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowered in earth and who made a lot of trips in earth. And ask him about ruh, the spirit. Here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As soon as he was asked these questions by the disbelievers, he told them, I will answer you tomorrow. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never to say this again. وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدَى إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ وَاذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ. Don't say tomorrow without saying inshaAllah. Here is Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the revelation was stopped for a period of time, but later on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the answers to these questions, two of them in Surah Al-Kahf and the third one in Surah Al-Isra. The one that we deal with is the one that has to do with the man who toured earth. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِلْقَرْنَيْنِ, and they ask you, O Muhammad, about ذِلْقَرْنَيْنِ, a man whose name is ذِلْقَرْنَيْنِ. Some people say that the man with the two horns, we don't want to get into the speculations of people there, but someone whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowered in earth, and this person used that power. You see, there is no harm, brothers and sisters in Islam, of being empowered in earth. Empowered through wealth, empowered through knowledge, empowered through IT, whatever power is out there, as long as you are utilizing this to serve the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to serve the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by doing so, you're helping your own self, and at the same time, you're helping the ummah. Here is Dhulqarnayn, a man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowered in earth. Inna makkanna lahu fil ardi wa ataynahu min kulli shay'in. We have empowered him on earth and we given him a lot of means. But he did not stop there. Rather, he also added to the means that we bestowed upon him. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Dhulqarnayn made three trips or more, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recorded in the Quran three trips. One to the west, one somewhere else, and the third one where those two tribes we're alive, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Let's take a short break and come back and talk about the story of this king, Dhulqarnayn, with the two tribes, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
The scale of justice will be broke before man. Now you shall have to explain your whole lifespan. You shall have to explain your whole lifespan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome back to the inevitable journey. Before the break, we were trying to figure out how did Ya'juj and Ma'juj exist before the second coming of Prophet Isa alayhi salam. And we said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quoted actually this in the Quran. in conjunction with the telling of the story of Dhil Qarnayn, a man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowered in earth. And he took so many journeys in earth, so many trips in earth, just to spread Islam and help the needy of the Muslims and to help the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here's, I'm quoting from Surah Al-Kahf, حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ. In one of his journeys, the third journey that was quoted, he reached a place between two mountains. وَجَدَ مِن دُونِهِمَا قَوْمًا لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ قَوْلًا. He found people there who do not comprehend easily, who do not understand easily, or the communication between them and Dhil Qarnayn was a little bit slow. They hardly understand the language of Dhil Qarnayn. حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ وَجَدَ مِن دُونِهِمَا قَوْمًا لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ قَوْلًا. In spite of the might of Dhil Qarnayn, and in spite of him so being so busy, but yet, and in spite of them not being able to understand him quickly, they hardly understand him, he took his time and he listened to them and he listened to their problem and listened to their complaint. And here is what they complained about him. قَالُوا يَا ذَا الْقَرْنَيْنِ إِنَّ يَأْجُوجَ وَمَأْجُوجَ. O Dhil Qarnayn, there are two tribes called Ya'juj and Ma'juj, مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. They are corrupting earth. Basically what they do is they come every now and then, and this is what is mentioned in the books of Tafsir, from between those two mountains, and they come and they invade our land, and they take our harvest, and they kill our children, and they destroy us, and then they go back, and then they visit us again. They are like a gang who show up every now and then just to cause them harm and cause corruption in earth, and then they go back to disappearing again. مُفْسُدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Now, فَهَلْ نَجْعَلُ لَكَ خَرْجًا عَلَىٰ أَن تَجْعَلَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمْ سَدًّا. Can we give you something in return? You will help us block that entry, because they come from between two mountains. If we block it, if you help us, we will build basically a block. So this way we will deter them from coming through those, in between those two mountains. Here is the attitude of this righteous king. You see, you could be a king and at the same time you could be righteous. Like Sulaiman alayhi salam, he said once he was bribed by the queen of Sheba, أَتُمِدُّونَنِ بِمَالٍ فَمَا آتَانِيَ اللَّهُ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا آتَاكُمْ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بِهَدِيَّتِكُمْ تَفْرَحُونَ. You are bribing me with money? You are bribing me with all these gold and silver that you're sending to me? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon me is much better than what you're giving to me right now. Here is, we see the attitude of Dhil Qarnayn, the same thing. قَالَ مَا مَكَّنِّي فِيهِ رَبِّي خَيْرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has empowered me with a lot of things, better than what you're offering me. But here is a good leader. You see, they wanted to basically have him do the work and they will chill and relax. I said, no. فَأَعِينُونِي بِقُوَّةِ. I want you to give me the manpower. I want you to help me with your manpower, with your strength, in order to execute that job for you. أَتُونِي زُبَرَ الْحَدِيدِ. Bring me the basically blocks of iron. حَتَّى إِذَا and pile it up between those two mountains. حَتَّى إِذَا سَاوَ بَيْنَ الصَّدَفَيْنِ. Until it reaches the top. قَالَ انْفُخُوا. And then make a fire underneath the iron. It will melt. So this way it will be hard to be pushed down by those numerous tribes, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Add to this, he also requested them to bring molten copper, which he basically made it in the top of them, so it became in a way lofty and slippery. فَمَسْطَاعُوا أَن يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَسْتَطَاعُوا لَهُ نَقْبًا. Those two tribes, they could not climb because it would be so slippery, or they could not dig through it because of the amount of strength that the iron covered by the molten copper did. And by the way, subhanallah, this happened years ago. Look at the engineering. If you want to be an engineer, right here in the Quran. And this is one of the miraculous things of the Quran, brothers and sisters in Islam. Here, right here, the Qarnayn, after finishing this job, qala hadha rahmatun min rabbi. هذا رحمة من ربي. This is, we done this because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to protect you from the evil of those two tribes. Right now, brothers and sisters in Islam, those two tribes exist. Where are the satellites that can give you the brand name of your underwear? Where are the satellites? Give me a break. These two tribes right now exist in the face of this earth. And I tell you, they exist. وَتَرَكْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ. They exist. Exist. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for them to come out from behind that wall that Dhil Qarnayn built. And by the way, في صحيح في سنن ابن حبان, سنن ابن ماجه, سنن الترمذي, مسند الإمام أحمد, حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us that every single day, by the way, they go and they dig that wall. Every day. And in another hadith, and the hadith صحيح الإمام البخاري, حديث زينب بنت جحش رضي الله عنها, the wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and a mother of the believers, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, one day he was asleep and he was disturbed in his sleep that his face turned red, and as soon as he woke up from his sleep, he said لا إله إلا الله. He did not say gosh, he did not say geez, he did not say cheese. He said la ilaha illallah. Repeat the word, brothers and sisters in Islam. Don't say gosh, don't say geez, say la ilaha illallah. Once you are disturbed, la ilaha illallah. You see, if you say it in these circumstances, inshallah, you will be empowered and enabled. You will be granted steadfastness to say it at the time of death and to say it when you need it most. Here is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is teaching you what to say once you are disturbed. He said la ilaha إله إلا الله ويل للعرب من شر قد اقترب. ويل, woe to the Arabs from evil that is about to occur. فتح اليوم من ردم يأجوج ومأجوج. And he did like this to them. Today يأجوج and مأجوج were able to dig a hole in that wall as big as this. So every single day, as we speak right now, يأجوج and مأجوج, we go back to hadith ابن حبان وابن ماجة والترمذي ومسلم الإمام أحمد من حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه, that every single day يأجوج and مأجوج will dig a hole in that wall. And look at this now. And then they get tired at the end of the day because the sun would set. And then the leader would say what? Okay, let's go back tomorrow. Without saying inshallah. Subhanallah. Inshallah even would help the disbelievers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the fact that their Amir did not say inshallah, Allah will make that hole go back blocked. No more. They come back tomorrow and say, we dig the hole in that thing. Where it is? It's not there anymore. You know why? Because they did not say, inshallah. وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدَى إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. Because you don't own tomorrow. You don't have tomorrow. Tomorrow is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters in Islam. And you should say always, inshallah. Because inshallah will not turn you to be a liar. Because if you tell me that you're going to do this tomorrow, how do you know that I'm not going to die? How do you know that you're not going to die? How do you know that this thing that you're about to do is not going to perish from the face of this earth? So even with the disbelievers, inshallah would help them. So they would come back tomorrow and they would find the same exact hole that they dig again blocked. They keep digging again. They keep digging again. And at the end of the day, they get tired and they leave a hole there in that wall. But then their Amir will say, okay, we're getting tired today. Let's come back tomorrow without saying inshallah. Ya Allah, without saying inshallah. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for them to come out from behind that wall, to do their work, the work that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for them to do. and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decree for them to come out at the time when Prophet Isa alayhi salam just killed the Antichrist, and he is softening the hearts of the believers and talking to them about Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decree that their Amir, their leader, will say, let's come back tomorrow, inshallah. Then they will come back tomorrow and they will find that hole that they digged because they said inshallah, the same way that they left it yesterday. They will finish digging and then they will come out from behind that wall and they will cause a lot of corruption in earth. And no one will dare will stand in their faces, in their ways. And that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Isa alayhi salam to take the Muslims, the believers, and seek refuge in the mountain of At-Tur. Let's find out how Prophet Isa alayhi salam will help the Muslims get rid of that fitna too, which is the fitna of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, the next episode. And let's find out the rest of the things that Prophet Isa alayhi salam will do in earth and the beautiful life people will enjoy after these trials and tribulations are over under the rule of Prophet Isa alayhi salam. Till the next episode of The Inevitable Journey. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
The scale of justice will be broke before man. Now you shall have to explain your whole lifespan. What you did in the open and what you concealed. From big to small shall today be revealed. Your deeds shall then be weighed in a scale. Shall determine if you pass or fail. Heaven and hell shall be brought into vision. Allah alone shall make the ultimate decision. To all brothers and sisters, I'd like to say, ask for forgiveness and do that today.